I invite you to open your Bibles this morning to Luke's Gospel, chapter number 14, please, the 14th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. You know, during this time of the year, about every year, I guess I could say, across the landscape of the college football world, there are new coaches that are implementing a new system and a new philosophy. And sometimes it takes those coaches quite a period of time to be able to implement that new philosophy and that new system. And sometimes the players, they kind of struggle with it. And yet, when those players buy into that new system, if the coach is a good coach, really good things can happen out on the field. And I've observed over the years that sometimes a new coach will come in and he will take a player that has greater ability and he will put him on the sideline, and he will choose a player that has lesser ability and he'll put him in the starting lineup. And the reason that he does that is because he knows that that player believes in him as the coach. And that player believes in the system, and that player believes in his philosophy. And he knows that here is a player that will just leave it all on the field for him. And that's the kind of player that he wants on his team. You know, Coach Jesus today is looking out across, I think, his church. And he's looking into the heart of this church. And really what he's looking for are those who truly have a desire to be on his team. Those who are willing to live with for him with an unflinching faith. Those that are willing to just lay it all on the line and leave it all on the field for him. What Coach Jesus is really looking for are those who will be devoted disciples of his. You see, every disciple of Christ is a Christian, but not every Christian is a practicing disciple of Christ. And you realize that there is absolutely nothing, I mean, the sky is the limit as to what God can do with a church that is filled with serious-minded disciples, followers of Jesus. There's nothing that he cannot do. I think of that early church. Man, they were untrained, they were uneducated, they were outnumbered, and yet they turned the world literally upside down. And it's not because they had great ability, it's not because they had tremendous talent, it's not because they had great wealth, you know, it's not because they were brilliant thinkers or great marketers. The reason, the thing that set them apart is that they were serious-minded disciples of Jesus Christ. And friend, I want to tell you, if somehow the Lord Jesus could find a whole bunch of folks here today who would say, you know what, Lord, I want to be on your team. I really want to be a serious-minded disciple of yours. The Lord could turn Bay County upside down, the state of Florida upside down, and our nation and our world upside down, if the Lord could just find those kinds of followers of his. So today, as we continue our series, Knowing God, I want to talk today about knowing God through discipleship. And I want you to look in Luke's Gospel, chapter 14. Here's a text we have to use because it's one of the greatest chapters in the Bible on discipleship. Now, this is Knowing God through Discipleship, part one, because I want to look at two or three other messages dealing with the same subject, and that is discipleship. But in Luke chapter 14, beginning with verse number 25, the Bible says, "And there went great multitudes with him, and he turned and he said unto them, If any man come to me and hate not his father and his mother and his wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth bear his cross, and whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me, cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he hath sufficient to finish it? Lest happily after he hath laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and he was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth a delegation and desireth conditions of peace. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor yet for the dunghill, but men cast it out. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now, let me say at the very outset of this message this morning that this is not a passage of Scripture that is dealing with salvation. You know, there are only two types of passages in the Bible. There are salvation passages and there are discipleship passages. And this is what we refer to as a discipleship passage, because he is not telling us here what the requirements are to be saved. Because if these were the requirements to be saved, friend, no one could be saved. I mean, who could do these things, give up all of these things in order to be converted? No, the only requirement to be saved is to come to Jesus Christ with trusting faith. But you see, if we want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, then there is a cost that is involved in that. And I really believe that that is what our Lord is teaching here, that those who want to go with me to a deeper level, those who want to walk with me as serious disciples, these are the things that are required, and you need to understand that there is a cost that is involved. You know, it's kind of like a baby growing into adulthood. You know, it's not something that merely just happens overnight, but there's a process that is involved. And I think many people who have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, they never become serious disciples of our Lord because they're just not willing to take the time to allow the process to work. Something I've learned is that when it comes to being a disciple, you know, God doesn't just text me in a moment, but he trains me over a lifetime. And that's what's involved in being a serious disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, a willingness to place ourselves at his feet for a lifetime where he can train us. Now, let me kind of set the scene as to what's going on here. The Bible tells us in the opening part of this text that there were great crowds that were following Jesus. So here is Jesus at this point in his ministry, and evidently he was quite popular, especially with the common folks. It seemed like the message of our Lord really resonated with their hearts. I think the common people, they kind of appreciated the way that the Lord Jesus deflated the religious establishment of that day, and how that he pointed out the hypocrisy of the Pharisees, who were the leaders of Judaism of that day. And they kind of appreciated it, that he had come into their area and he was preaching about a kingdom that was open and was accessible unto all. And yet when we get to this point of the story and Jesus starts talking about all of these strange sounding requirements of being a follower of his, it's not, you know, like he seems like he's trying to attract more. It seems like he's trying to thin the crowd out. It's like he was saying, look, if you want to be my disciple, then listen, you cannot be unless you are willing to allow these things to be a part of your life. So it was like, you know, the Lord's kind of drawing a special group to himself. I think what he's doing is he's gathering himself an army, those that would be his A-team, you might say, those that would be his special forces. The Lord wasn't just looking for the adoring masses at this time. He had a whole lot of those. I mean, all of these folks, they were Jesus fans. All of these, from outward appearance, they believed in him and they loved him. And yet he said to them, listen, if you want to be my disciple and if you want to go in the trenches with me and fight the enemy, then these things are required of you. Do I have any takers? Are there really any who are willing to follow after me? And I really believe that that is what the Lord is saying to the church today. Listen, the masses are here, but are there any that are willing to step across that line and go the next level and be on my A-team and help me conquer this world with the gospel? You see, friends, he's not talking here about salvation, because three times he said, if you do not do these things, you cannot be my disciples. He did not say you cannot be a Christian. He said you cannot be my disciples. Now, friend, I want to know what these things are and how to do them, because I'm telling you, I want to be a disciple. Can I get a witness? Don't you want to be a serious-minded, devoted disciple of Jesus Christ? And yet, really, the sad reality is that there are scores of people, good people in churches, that are not devoted disciples of Jesus Christ. And dear friend, the main reason that the Lord saved us is not just to take us to heaven when we die, but it's to make us for us to make a difference while we're alive and while we're here. So what are these requirements? There are three things that I want us to see out of this text today. And the first is just simply the cost of discipleship. The cost. Now in verses 26 through 27, where he's talking about hating and bearing your cross and all of that stuff, these are what the scholars of today refer to as the hard sayings of Jesus. And in reality, they're not hard at all if you really interpret them properly and correctly. Now what he's simply saying is, listen now, salvation is free. Salvation is a gracious gift from God when we come to him with believing faith in Jesus Christ. But there is a cost to discipleship. There is a price that we're going to have to pay if we want to be a disciple of our Lord. And he mentions about three costs here that I want to bring to your attention. Number one is, he says there will be a relational cost. A relational cost. Now look in verse number 26. In verse 26 he says, if any man comes to me, hates not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now friend, this sounds strange, doesn't it? And I want to tell you what, if you don't interpret this verse within the context of the rest of the teaching of the Lord Jesus, man, this thing here is going to throw you for a loop. Now, let me just make one thing clear. Jesus is not telling us to hate anyone. If he was telling us to hate someone, he would be contradicting so many of the other statements that he made in the New Testament. For example, how could the Lord Jesus tell us to honor our mother and father on the one hand and then turn right around and tell us to hate them? How could he tell a husband to love his wife as Christ loved the church and then tell a husband here to hate his wife? How could the Lord Jesus, who invited little children to come to him, because the Bible says he loved them and he prayed for them and blessed them, and how could he now tell parents to hate those children? How could the Lord Jesus tell us in the Sermon on the Mount to be reconciled to our brothers and sisters, but now tell us that we're to hate our brothers and sisters? How could he tell us in the Sermon on the Mount that we're to love our enemies, but now tell us that we're to hate ourselves? Friend, he's not telling us to do that. What Jesus was doing was living out in the context of his day. And he was simply using a very popular rabbinical method of teaching that was referred to as the usage of the sharp contrast. In other words, the Jewish rabbis of that day would use what they call the sharp contrast in order to make a point. And there could be no sharper contrast than the contrast between hate and love. Now, friend, if you listen right here, say amen. What the Lord Jesus was saying is that if you want to be my disciple, then your love for your husband, for your wife, for your parents, for your children, for your siblings, for your friends, your love for them in comparison to your love for me must be like hate. He was saying, your love for me is to be so profound and so passionate and so prioritized that your love for anyone else isn't on the same page. In fact, it's not even in the same library. That when you compare your love for others, husband, wife, children, parents, whatever it might be, it's not even to be close. Now, friend, I don't know about you, but I don't know if I'm there yet. Are you there yet? Jesus said, if we're not, we can't be his disciples. Now, why in the world would the Lord Jesus point out this idea of there being a relational cost if we're going to be a disciple of His? It is because Jesus knew that oftentimes our love for family and friends will hinder our commitment to Him. That's what He knew. You know, as a pastor, I've seen this happen over and over again. I've seen someone get saved, go home, tell their family about it. Family doesn't like it. I've seen a wife get saved and go home, and there's some lost husband there in the family. He doesn't like it. I've seen some child get saved and go home, tell their parents, and their parents won't even let them be baptized. And all I can say is, may God have mercy on a parent like that. You know, I've seen it happen over and over and over again. And sometimes that new convert, what they will do, instead of having conflict in the home, they'll just tone down their zeal for Jesus Christ. Friends, what we've got to understand today is this. Listen carefully. When we give our lives to Christ and we are serious about being a disciple of Christ, not everybody's going to like it. And not everyone's going to appreciate us. And not everyone's going to be for us. Jesus said, listen, they hated me and they're going to hate you too. You as the student, you're not any better than your teacher. And if they hated your teacher, you can just mark it down. They're going to hate you. And so there are times because of our commitment to Christ as a disciple of Christ that commitment is going to offend people and bother people. You know, there are going to be some old party friends that you used to party with, you can't party with anymore, and they're not going to like it. There are going to be some that are going to be uncomfortable in your presence because they can't swear around you like they used to and feel comfortable. Friend, you can just mark it down. If we're going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, we're going to either live, listen, in harmony with God and in friction with some people, or we will either live in harmony with some people and be in friction with God. And if you today are not living in conflict with somebody because of your faith, you're probably not a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, friends, I'm not saying that we ought not be kind and gracious and compassionate. We ought to be, and we ought to be even more so if we're followers of Jesus Christ. But dear friend, listen, we're never to allow the potential of conflict to hinder our zeal and our service and our love for the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, I have seen that oftentimes what God will use to awaken an unbeliever's awareness of their need for God is conflict that is caused by someone's stand for their faith. But something I've never seen God use us compromising in order to prevent conflict, compromising our faith. I've never seen the Lord use that to awaken a person's awareness of their need for God. So if you want to be my disciple, understand there is a relational cost. But secondly, he says there is a sacrificial cost. Down in verse number 27, Jesus says, whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me, he cannot be my disciple. Now, what did he mean by bearing the cross? Jesus just simply said, if you want to be my disciple, you've got to do what I did. What did Jesus do? Jesus died. And you see, the cross in the culture of that day, it was a symbol of death. You realize that, you know, you never would have seen anyone of that day wearing a piece of jewelry around their neck that was fashioned in the form of a cross. That was a symbol of death. It would be kind of like today, someone wearing a piece of jewelry hanging around their neck that looks like an electric chair. You would look at someone like that and say, man, they're weirded out. Who would do anything like that? Well, they would think the same thing because when they thought about the cross, and so many times I'm sure that as they went into the city of Jerusalem to do business or to buy their produce or whatever it might be, they could hear the Roman soldiers and the clanking of the armor as someone was being drug off to be crucified. So what they were thinking about when they thought about the cross was dying. And Jesus has just said, look, if you want to be my disciple, you got to love me more than your family, more than your friends, more than anything or anyone. And now I'm telling you what you've got to do is you have got to die to yourself. You've got to get rid of those things that are challenging your allegiance to me. Are you willing to spell death to them? One of my favorite authors, A.W. Tozer, said, and I quote, he said, in every Christian heart there is a cross and a throne. And the Christian is on the throne until he puts himself on the cross. If he refuses the cross, he remains on the throne. End of quote. And I would add, he cannot be Christ's disciple. You see, friend, in order for us to be saved, Jesus does all the dying. But in order for us to be a disciple, we do all the dying. Now, I want to ask you seriously, what's on your list and mine that we need to die to, that we need to bury, that we need to get rid of in order to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? But Pastor, I love that thing, or I love that person. That's the problem. You love that thing or that person more than you love the Lord Jesus. Friend, listen, what do you need to get rid of today? And I bet right now that the Holy Spirit of God is bringing something to your mind that is such a hindrance to your allegiance to Jesus Christ. And it's stopping you and hindering you from being His disciple. Friend, it's not enough just to get saved. We got to move on to becoming disciples. So there is a relational cost. There's a sacrificial cost. We got to die and bury those things. There is a possessional cost. In verse number 33, Jesus says, so likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. Now, does Jesus mean that? Does he mean we got to go home today and have a giant yard sale and just get rid of everything that we own? Come on now, Lord. You know, I can put up with a little conflict in my family, but you want my boat too? Is that what he's saying? Friend, that can't be what he's saying because, listen, if Joseph of Arimathea would have done that, Jesus wouldn't have had a tomb to be buried in. He didn't give up all that he had. You know what he's talking about there? That little word there, forsake all, it just literally means to yield, listen, to yield your right to claim. Until you yield your right to claim. To claim what? Ownership of what, Pastor? Of anything. You know, we talk about our homes, our cars, our boats, our children, our grandchildren, our money, mine, 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 mine. That's not the attitude of a disciple. The attitude of a disciple is, Lord, everything that I have, you own it, Lord, you own it. That really can be a great blessing. Someone told me last week after Sunday morning, I preached about Satan, and they said, Pastor, get ready for an attack this week. Let me tell you what happened this week. My microwave died. My lawnmower died. My stove died. And in preparing for this sermon, something else died? Okay. That I don't know about. And in preparing for this sermon, it was such a blessing because Friday afternoon when I was trying to get my grass cut, and got about half of it cut, and it died. You know, that's what it always does. It. My first temptation was just to get mad, and then I said, Lord, your lawnmower just broke. What you going to do about it? So there really is a blessing. There's a great joy in being able to know that our possessions are not ours. They do not belong to us, but they belong to the Lord. And the problem so many times is that we are treating stuff that's not ours like we own it. It's like a lady I read about, she'd had a rough day at work, so she decided that she was going to treat herself to a reward, so she went down to the mall. Got to the mall, she located the cookie store, and she bought her a fresh bag of chocolate chip cookies that had just been made. Stepped next door to Starbucks and got her a vanilla, whatever they call those things, latte. Heavy on the cream. Went and found her little secluded spot there in that area of the mall, sat down at a table, pulled a magazine out of her purse, began to read it, and she was just taking the bite of her first cookie, and some man came in and sat down right across the table from her. She had been sitting there reading for a few minutes, and all of a sudden she thought that she heard the rustling of her cookie bag. She said, "Surely that can't be," so she didn't even look up. Kept eating her cookie. A few moments later, she heard another rustle. And she peered over the top of her magazine, and as she did, she was almost positive she saw his hand coming out of that bag with a cookie in it. This happened for several minutes and just went on and on and on. And finally, she looked over the magazine. She caught him red-handed. Had one of those cookies of hers coming out of that bag. She couldn't believe it. They got down to the last cookie. Both hands hit that cookie at the same time. And you know what he did? He broke it in half. Smiled at her and gave her one half of the cookie. She bolted up from that table, ran out to the parking lot, reached in her purse to get her keys to unlock her car. And guess what she felt when she reached in her purse? A bag. He wasn't eating her cookies. She was eating his. And we talk about, you know, our money, our cars, our home, our cookies. We don't own a thing. We have forgotten the principle of 1 Corinthians chapter 6, where the Word of God says, you are not your own. You've been bought with a price. The attitude of a disciple is, Lord, everything I have, it belongs to you, and it's to be used in a way that's pleasing to you, that honors and glorifies you. But there is a possessional cost. So we see the cost of discipleship. But secondly, we see the calculation of discipleship in verse number 28. For which of you intending to build a tower sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient resources to finish it? And he goes on and he just talks about the idea of we need to calculate the cost that is involved in being a disciple. Friend, I tell you what we need to calculate today. What we need to calculate is the path that leads us to, listen, the destination of discipleship. And what is that path as we begin to calculate it that leads us to being a disciple? I think that when we follow the example of the disciples, we see it pointed out to us so clearly. When I think about these that the Lord called to be his disciples, what was it that happened that made them practicing disciples? Number one is that they started by being curious. Study their life, and you will see that they looked at the Lord Jesus. They heard him teach. They saw him in action. They observed his life, and they were curious about him. Who is this one who is named Jesus? Curious. And being curious led them to being convinced. It's interesting when you read John chapter 2, verse number 11, the Bible says when Jesus turned the water into wine, he revealed his glory unto them. That is that he revealed unto them that he was the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Son of God. So that curiosity led them to being convinced. And if you're here today and you're just in the curious stage, man, that's good. That's good. You just keep looking. You just keep observing. You just keep watching. You just keep reading. You just keep praying. And one day, you like these disciples, you will be convinced about this one you're curious over. He indeed is the Son of God. So it started by being curious. It led them to being convinced. And that led them to being converted, because they believed he was who he said he was. And then he converted them. We know that they were converted because Simon Peter in Matthew chapter 16 stands up and boldly confesses, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." But dear friend, that's not the final step. I'm telling you, it's not the final step. Just being curious and being convinced and being converted, it's not enough. Because there comes a time in life we've got to step across that line to being committed. Committed. You see, we can be curious, convinced, and converted, and still not be committed as a disciple of Jesus Christ. And I honestly do believe that that is where many of church members in America are today. Yes, they've gotten curious, and yes, they became convinced, and yes, they were even converted, but they have fallen short of stepping across that line to being committed. And friend, it is committed disciples that the Lord Jesus Christ uses to make a difference in this world. It was Eugene Peterson who said, "Discipleship is anything that causes what is believed in the heart to have demonstrable consequences in our daily life." That's good. Discipleship is anything that is believed in the heart to have demonstrable consequences in our daily life. That's discipleship. What difference does it make on Monday that I come to church on Sunday? What difference does it make in my workplace, in my school place, in my home place? Are there demonstrable actions that take place during the week involving others because of what I say that I believe that is in my heart? There's one final thought here. Not only the cost of discipleship and the calculation of discipleship, but the converse of discipleship. The converse. What happens if we just kind of hear the sermon today, but we go no further? I'm saved, secure, on my way to heaven. That's enough. What is the converse of discipleship and not going on to being committed? Well, Jesus said in verse 34, salt is good, but if the salt has lost its savor or saltiness, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor yet for the dunghill. But men just cast it out. He hath ears to hear. You better hear, he says, what I'm saying. What is the converse? If I just say, all right, I've heard what the Lord says, but you know what? I am not going on to commitment. The converse is we become saltless Christians. Now, you know, we talk about salt, we talk about sodium, we talk about chloride. What is that? That's a stable compound. Technically speaking, salt can't lose its saltiness. But salt, through the infiltration of impurities, can lose the taste of its saltiness. And what good is it if that happens? And what the Lord is saying is that if you do not go on to be my disciples, you're going to lose your saltiness. You're going to lose your influence. You're going to lose your effectiveness. And ultimately, you're going to lose your rewards. There's a big deal about not becoming a fully devoted follower of Jesus Christ that we would call a disciple. And dear friend, when they thought about salt in the ancient world, friend, it was something a whole lot more than just something you made popcorn taste good with. But salt was used for a couple of different reasons. It was used for preservation. You know, they had no refrigeration in those days. And so they would wrap the meat in salt to preserve it so that it wouldn't rot, so that it would not putrefy. And if they didn't wrap it in that salt, then that's what would happen. And Jesus said to us, "You're the salt of the earth." Why did he say that? Because his plan to preserve culture from putrefying, rotting, and starting to stink was us. That's his plan. And friend, in case you have not noticed, we are living in the midst of a stinking culture. It is a rotten culture. It has putrefied far beyond anything it's ever been before in the history of the world. And what is the only answer for this putrefaction, for this stench, for this rotting in our culture? Friend, the answer is not found in the politicians. The answer is found in disciples of Jesus Christ. We're the ones who are the answer. And you see, since the solution is disciples, and only Christians can be disciples, the answer for the societal ills of America is not found in the halls of Congress, it's found in the heart of the church. And friend, if we don't rise up, we don't stand up, we are not counted, we are not disciples, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. This culture is going to just rot away right out from underneath our feet. I cannot think of a time in the history of the church where it's been more needful for you and I to be the salt and to be disciples of Christ. See, what does salt do? It was used for protection. It was used for preservation. It was used for stimulation. What does salt do? Salt creates thirst. And I think what Jesus is saying when he said, you're the salt of the earth, is that when you get around those who are unbelievers, your lifestyle ought to create a thirst for God in them. When they're around you and observe your actions and see you in real life, friend, when unbelievers are around us, they ought to taste our salt and ought to create a thirst in their souls to know God. What is the Lord looking for today as he looks throughout the church? Disciples. Disciples. The great evangelist John Wesley said, you give me 100 men who love nothing but God and fear nothing but sin, and I'll move the world. Give us that today, and the church can move the world. What's the Lord looking for? He's looking for disciples. He's looking for those who will sign up and be on his team. He's looking for those who will play that game of the Christian life with all of their hearts. He is looking for those who will give it their very best and leave it all on the field. He is looking for those who can, like the Apostle Paul, end life by looking back and saying, I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I have kept the faith, and I have absolutely no regrets for the way that I've lived my life for the glory of God. That's what he's looking for. He is looking for disciples, those of us who will be stones to help build his church, who will be soldiers to help fight his enemies, those of us who will be salt to help preserve the good that is in our culture. That's what he's looking for. But does he have any takers in this building today? Is there anyone in this place who will stand for him? Back in the late 1800s, there was an Episcopalian priest whose name was Dudley Ting. Powerful Episcopalian priest. That's before the Episcopalians lost their theological minds. Powerful man of God. Unexplainable everywhere he went and preached. Hundreds were converted. He had such an anointing of God that was upon his life. 1867, Dudley Ting was preaching at a YMCA meeting. Over 200 adult men gave their lives to Jesus Christ in that particular meeting. And it was during that sermon that Dudley Ting made this statement. He said, I would rather have my right arm severed at the trunk than to fail to carry out my master's errand. 3 days later, he visited a friend who had a farm. Dudley Ting had a long coat on, and somehow the end of his coat got caught in the mule-driven corn thrasher, and it yanked his arm off. The feed that was in that corn thrasher got into his bloodstream. Gangrene set in. Obviously, he was rushed to the hospital. They had him packed down in ice, burning up with fever, and it was apparent that he was going to die within a few hours. His father was there, who happened to be a preacher also. And Dudley Ting, it is said, took his left arm, reached over, grabbed his father by the coat, pulled him close, and said, "Father, stand up for Jesus." And you tell my preacher brethren to stand up for Jesus. And then he died. They had his memorial service a few days later, and that story was related of what Dudley had said to his father. There was a Presbyterian pastor in the service that day by the name of George Duffield. He heard that story. George Duffield went home that afternoon and wrote these words, stand up for Jesus. Ye soldiers of the cross, lift high his royal banner. It must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed. Friend, you're the dear people of God. You've been saved by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. If you don't stand up for him, who will? Who will? No one. Jesus looks out across this audience today and says, is there anybody here who will stand up for me? Is there anyone here who will put it all on the line? Is there anyone here who will live with a reckless abandonment of faith for me? Is there anyone here who will become radical, sold out in their living for me? I don't know about you, but Lord, I volunteer. I want to be one of those, don't you? Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. Before we can do anything we've talked about today, the first step is conversion. You've been curious about Jesus, and you've actually been convinced he's the Savior of the world. And now you need to allow him to convert you to be your own personal Savior. So if you've never made that decision, trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, we invite you to do that today. You're here today and you just may want to use this altar, or you may want to make a public recommitment of your life to the Lordship of Christ, or you may want to join this church. Whatever the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart about doing, may you do that today. God, how grateful that we are for the opportunity that we have to live for something that has meaning and purpose. And I pray that we would give the best of ourselves for kingdom living. And Lord, that we would lay it on the line for you. I pray for those spiritual decisions that need to be made today, that they would be made during this invitation. In Christ's name. Heads are bowed and eyes closed.